Your dreams are bigger, bolder, and more badass than the life you're living now. But something just keeps getting in the way. Join certified coach and former therapist Diann Wingert for the Driven Woman podcast. She'll show you how to get rid of whatever is holding you back so you can stop spinning your wheels and up-level your life. Get ready to hop in and buckle up. This is the Driven Woman podcast, and we're heading for the fast lane.
Well, hello, hello, and welcome back to my fellow Driven Women. Can I just tell you how much I am enjoying all of your wonderful podcast praise? This one made me laugh out loud. The writer is SDPS Davis, who says, "Be driven without driving yourself crazy." As a driven woman who sometimes takes a wrong turn, I appreciate Diann's ability to see through the fluff and distractions to get to the heart of the matter. Thanks, Diann. Well, thank you for this wonderful podcast praise, SDPS Davis. I'm such a curious person. I wish I knew what those letters meant, and I wish I knew your true identity and perhaps the name of your business and your social media handles. I would include all of them in the show notes. But since I don't, I will simply have to say a sincere thank you. And keep on listening. There is way more good stuff where what you've already heard came from. Today's episode is a solo show. Have you ever heard the term, "You're so intimidating," or "You're threatening"? Has that been said about you and to you? Have you overheard it in reference to you? What do you think it means? Well, starting from high school, I have regularly been told that I'm intimidating. It hurt my feelings. It made me mad. I tried so hard to figure out why and what I could do to make it stop, but it never went away. And years later, my teenage daughter got the same feedback. I will share my journey with that expression, what I made it mean, what I now understand it means, and why it makes all the sense in the world that I became an entrepreneur. Enjoy. I don't know what your thoughts on the topic are, but I recently heard someone say that starting your own business is a feminist act. I find that very interesting. Not sure that I agree with it, but what I do know is that many people find a self-employed woman to be very threatening. From the time I was a teenager, I started hearing that I was threatening, that I was intimidating. It didn't seem to matter much if I was talking to a chick or a dude. This kind of comment came at me from both genders and in a variety of circumstances. Now, you should be aware that I happen to be tall, like 5'10 tall, relatively intelligent, and considered by conventional standards to be not bad looking. I also have an outgoing personality. I'm educated. I communicate very honestly and very directly. I possess a raunchy sense of humor, a deep appreciation of sarcasm, and I do use colorful language to emphasize my point. Plus, I have a decent amount of self-confidence. Now, while this combination of attributes might trigger all kinds of impressions, I had a really hard time understanding exactly what it was about me that made me intimidating. I mean, it's not like I'm aggressive, overbearing, or physically overpowering. In fact, I have always gone out of my way to be friendly, warm, and focused on the other person. I was a therapist for over 20 years, for crying out loud. Now, I have since learned that in the psychological literature, people tend to give us tall folks more credit than we probably deserve by attributing intelligence, attractiveness, and success to those that are taller than the norm, just because we're tall. Now, that didn't seem to me to be the whole story in my case. I just couldn't get anyone to explain to me what the actual whole story was. I mean, at first it was surprising, then it was confusing, then it made me feel sad, lonely, and often alienated. I began to feel like people were making impressions of me that were inaccurate, unfair, and I couldn't do anything about them. Eventually, it started to piss me off. I mean, I hadn't done anything to distance myself from others or them from me, and yet they continued to draw conclusions about me that were negative and judgmental. I'm not a people pleaser per se, but I want to be liked and accepted as much as anyone. And I just didn't understand what I was supposed to do to make myself less intimidating. Well, fast forward a few decades from when I first started getting those comments. I had married and had a family. And by the time my third child and only daughter was a senior in high school, she started getting the same comments. Now, she's several inches shorter than I am and has a totally different personality type. She's a conflict avoider, an Enneagram 9 for those who know, and wants nothing more than for everyone around her to just get along and be happy. It made even less sense that she was being told she was intimidating than when I got the same feedback. She was even told by an employer that she needed to smile more because customers indicated they thought she might be unapproachable. She began to refer to herself as having resting bitch face. If you check the Urban Dictionary, it's the term for a woman who is not constantly trying to appear receptive to interactions with others, even the ones she wants. Well, all of a sudden, I realized what the problem was, the real problem. It's not that I was intimidating or that my daughter looks like a bitch, which I suppose to many people is more or less the same thing. It's that our culture has programmed us to think that women need to suppress all of the traits and qualities that might be perceived as strong, independent, assertive, self-sufficient, confident, or secure, so that we can appear to be more passive, more receptive, and more approachable than we actually are. You're intimidating is just what people say to smart, attractive, secure women in order to suppress the fact that we might actually be more interested in whatever it is we find important instead of swiveling our attention in your direction just because that's what you want. Now, I am open-minded enough to recognize that this kind of cultural conditioning may not actually be intentional. I like to think it's typically unconscious on the part of the person giving such feedback. If I actually believed it was deliberate and malicious, well, that falls under the category of harassment in my book, and even outright oppression. Now, it might be that that's exactly what it is, but I prefer to live in a world where I give people the benefit of the doubt, at least until they prove me wrong. What I really can't quite wrap my mind around, though, and honestly find truly incomprehensible, is that women do this to other women. There are places where this happens more often, and religious organizations, unfortunately, are often at the top of the list. During the years I was attending an evangelical church, I never heard the word intimidating directly, but boy, I sure got a lot of messages about my dominant personality and how it just needed to be toned down. I always felt different than the other women, and I was used to this. Until one day, several of the elders of our church paid me an unscheduled visit, telling me they had come to pray with me about my strong will, because, in their way of thinking, it was preventing my then husband from being the spiritual head of our home, as God intended. They even gave me a lecture and the copy of a book called Husbands Who Won't Lead and Wives Who Won't Follow, written by a man, of course, for married couples like us, the ones where the woman's powerful personality was being blamed on her husband's less powerful one, the personality he had long before I ever came into his life. By this time, those intimidating comments had gone beyond merely informing me there was something wrong and had now ventured into blaming me for my husband's perceived shortcomings as a man and husband. Needless to say, both my relationship with said husband and the church began to unravel not long after that. What I now understand is that intimidating is the code word for masculine, and masculine is what our culture believes of personality traits that are considered desirable in men and undesirable in women, traits that convey intelligence, assertiveness, ambition, and self-assuredness, traits that are so highly prized in men, yet suppressed and sometimes repressed in women, that we openly mock, denigrate, and insult the women who possess them. I even had a prospective coaching client once tell me that she decided not to hire me because she found me, and I quote, too confident. For once, I was actually speechless. I mean, who wouldn't want their coach to be confident? How can we guide, lead, and mentor our coaching clients unless we are confident? Well, I didn't try to convince her otherwise. We obviously can't connect with a client in a helpful way if they find us intimidating. But the question is, who owns the label? I mean, if people call me intimidating, does it mean that I am? How much responsibility do I hold for other people's opinions? And if a woman is confident, independent, and knows her own mind, not only is she going to trigger people of all genders who don't possess those traits, it's also pretty likely that sooner or later, she will also recognize she is better suited to self-employment. Instead of trying to force herself to fit into the box, she can create her own box, or better yet, forgo boxes altogether. If you're a female entrepreneur, whether you own a small business, a private practice, a brick-and-mortar retail store, a coaching empire, or a virtual consultancy, sooner or later, you will be told in one way, shape, or form that you are intimidating. The label might sound a little different, and the feedback might be packaged as well-meaning advice, but whenever a woman goes her own way, instead of following conventional norms, feathers will be ruffled among the rest of the flock. It's a fact of life that most humans prefer to stick with the herd. They want to be one of the gang, to fit in, to belong. If we want to be reassured that we're doing the right things in life, then we had better do what everyone else is doing, right? The safe choice will always appear to be the one that the majority of people are making, which in the world of work is a J-O-B, preferably full-time, long-term, secure, and with the usual benefits. If you grew up hearing that you are intimidating because you're a woman who likes to think her own thoughts, make her own choices, and trust her own instincts, becoming an entrepreneur might just be the most provocative thing you could possibly do. Hey, it's no secret that women are turning to self-employment in record numbers for so many reasons, but sadly, many of them will fail. And it's not because they're not smart enough, savvy enough, or skilled enough. It's because of the limiting beliefs they unconsciously carry. Beliefs about who they are and what they're capable of, based on feedback from others going all the way back to childhood. An intelligent, independent, and opinionated daughter who's being raised by easily intimidated parents has been told she was intimidating as long as she can remember. And years later, those self-doubts will interfere with her ability to be successful as an entrepreneur. Many of us were told we were intimidating, and as a result, we've become lone wolves. But a wolf pack not only offers safety in numbers, just like being a sheep in a herd, it's also a place to celebrate those so-called intimidating traits. If you have not found your wolf pack yet, I want to invite you to join us in the Driven Woman Facebook group. There you will discover what a difference it can make to connect with like-minded females who truly get you. And you can just say bye, Felicia, to being told you're intimidating once and for all. Hey, I hope you're enjoying listening to the Driven Woman podcast and looking forward to each new episode every Tuesday. Are you ready to take our relationship to the next level? Visit my website at diannwingardcoaching.com. I have a weekly blog. There's a quiz you can take to find out what your ADHD signature strength is, and some other freebies like the 6 steps to ADHD mastery or the Driven Woman Roadmap Fast Track to Success. And if you're ready to get serious about going from spinning to winning and taking yourself from driven but distracted to focused, fired up, and flame retardant, you should definitely sign up for a free consultation. We'll spend 30 minutes talking about where you are, where you want to be, and whatever's getting in the way. I won't try to sell you if you're not right for coaching and I'm not the right one for you. But if you are, this might be the best way to make 2021 your best year ever. Want to hear from someone who's actually worked with me? Have a listen to my client, Rachel.
I didn't have you helping me along the way to understand a lot of this stuff. The meds would have been a waste for me, a complete and total waste. I would have had a little bit more energy maybe, but still the habits, whatever. There's no magic pill. It's always going to be something I'm going to have to work on. And I am understanding that and being okay with that and just kind of working through that and thinking and being intentional and stopping myself and doing all of the things for the first time in my life. I'm going to tell you right now, the meds have allowed me to slow stuff down enough that I've never been this effective at anything cognitive ever in my life. But I've also never had it explained to me by somebody who understands what's going on in my head either.
You've been listening to the Driven Woman podcast with Diann Wingert. Want more straight talk and strategy each week that will take you from spinning to winning? Don't forget to hit subscribe in your podcast player so you won't miss a single episode. Then head on over to the Driven Woman free and private Facebook group community. See you there.